And it might be that you have found a way to live to be 175, but your work capacity is to get there, it has to be super blunted. So if I hold very, very still and do nothing but just eat right, say, I might live to be 200. And I don't know that's not the case. It would surprise me to find out that were the case. I think we've got some pretty good evidence to suggest that it's not, to support the contention that it's not the case. But whether it is the case or not, I think is an important question, and it won't be resolved until we start to look at this kind of thing. And so what I want to do is just get us all to agree that these are things that need to be measured to give meaningful discussion to very important questions like the one you just asked. Now, you want me to bet on where it's going to be? Yeah, that I think we want to establish a high level of work capacity early and hold it for as long as possible would be my hope for you. Yeah. What's interesting, I talk about the guy who comes to me at 50, Dr. Mullis, and has never done any of these things before. What we'd find is that curtain, if you will, if you can kind of follow my miming of three-dimensional data here, what we'd find is that he was always very low and then came to us and had this thing kicked up. And what does that portend for his future? We have seen too many people that were on the verge of losing a condominium to the nursing home because they couldn't negotiate the stairs, and now they can. People that have gone from walker to cane, or cane to hands-free, or having to make multiple trips up the stairs with groceries, and now they can do it with one. And I believe, with fair conviction, that how ambulatory we are will have a significant impact on life expectancy. You know, we as a culture of athletes and non-athletes alike, it's kind of just a Western sieve phenomenon. We live in fear and dread of cancer and heart disease. And I want to tell you that's not generally what puts people in nursing homes. It's medical feebleness. It's when you're called to Thanksgiving dinner and you're having trouble getting off the sofa because it's all plush and you're sunk in, and you're pulling on the coffee table and it upsets, and you can't get to your feet, and you're looking around, and then two people come up and get you under the arm and walk you to the table. It's that loss of functional independence that I think presages a radical diminution in your life quality and leads to a death, is my sense of it. And we have known firsthand that we can alter that horizon line for just about anybody, just about anyone. You start with us on a walker, I'm going to get you a cane. You start with a cane, I'm going to get you free of it. You can't go up the stairs with a sack of groceries. You'll be able to do it with two when we're done. You know, in this defining of terms, because we're right on the subject here, in looking at power output, I was sitting at a presenter in a conference on functional fitness for the Marine Corps. And there were exercise physiologists there, physicians there, heavy Navy, heavy Marine, and lots of gurus from my industry. And for 2 days straight, it was functional fitness, functional fitness, functional fitness. I told one of the Canadian kids sitting next to me, just listen to how often functional said. And it became, you know, this blah, 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 functional, blah, 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 functional, functional, blah, blah, blah. And for 2 days, no one defined it. And so I got the Pilates people nodding, this is cool, the Swiss ball people, this is really great, the TheraBand people are all excited, the weightlifters are excited, and none of us are talking about the same thing, but we're using the same word. And when we started looking at functional fitness, we had to, again, maybe not give concrete defining parameters to the term, but started just listing the characteristics of what we meant when we talked about functional movements to differentiate it from what others meant. And it was things that came, compound complex movements that radiated in this wave of contraction from core to extremity, where I start with high force producing low velocity body parts yielding in this seamless daisy chain of contraction to eventually high velocity, low force producing. We said that these things were natural in the most fundamental sense of it, that they were tied to your DNA, that if I were to take a crude drawing of schematic in the macro sense of a human, so I present a drawing like this of someone in a squat, and if you can see someone in a squat here, that's going to help a lot. But if you're just to present a drawing like this and talk about the origin and insertion of the muscles and the bones, you know, that is the levers involved, and ask an intelligent being with an entirely different life form, how would this object maximally go overhead, and what you're going to find is the answer is a jerk. That's just how that is. That's the physics of it. It's tied to that physiognomy. How would this same creature go from something that you're standing above and going to pull and want to then get it overhead? You're going to find it's clean or snatch, baby. Those are about your choices. Those are, there's huge efficiency. And in fact, some of the characteristics of these functional movements is that they're efficient and effective locomotors of body and external object. And it was that efficiency and efficacy that can be given mathematical definition that actually got us to see ultimately, after looking at this long list of characteristics of functional movements that was consistent with our use of the term and tended to exclude what happened on the Swiss ball in Pilates doing the thigh master and doing yoga, what we saw is that the functional movements could be defined nicely, very tidily, as these movements that are unique in their capacity to move large loads long distance quickly. And boy, that's good stuff. Now you're on to something, which again brings in the whole power bit here, because that is, what do we have? Large loads, long distance quickly, force distance and time. We're talking about power once again. It has been suggested to us by some of our biology friends that this definition of fitness applies on the molecular level at the cellular level as well, too. Every one of our state, federal, municipal, and foreign implementations, what we found is that our program was matched against business as usual, being adjudicated by the standards of the system currently in place, which, you know, on some level is not quite fair, but we're not complaining because we're winning. And so what we have is at Naval Special Warfare within Canadian Forces, at Colorado State Patrol, in the Jacksonville Sheriff's Office, they had an extant program with its standards for success, and we had to compete against that program by those other standards. It was our contention that really the best way to do this would be to pit programs A and B against some standards of a program C. That neither of us should be grading our own homework, but it pretty much became a no-brainer, and at the point that we were able to best a in-house program by the in-house standard, they pretty much rolled over for us. We haven't done any of our own. There's been some internal stuff, but I don't share it because it would be quickly and readily dismissed, especially out of academia. But what we've got, the wonderful position now is that I have my harshest critics doing some of the best studies on our effort. And when a civilian agency undertakes an examination of CrossFit to prove its inappropriateness for the SEALs, and then it ends up implemented as a curriculum at BUDS, you know, I feel pretty good about that we had our competition, if you will, run the test for us, and it's really greased the skids for acceptance. Right now, I tell you what, if I had a choice of another implementation or acceptance or a pat on the back and attaboy or any of that stuff versus finding some chink in our arm or something that we're doing wrong to be done better, I'd take the latter and quickly. My commitment is to advancing human performance, not to CrossFit's current methodology. Maybe methodology in the heuristic, in the sense of philosophical approach to that is staying committed to measuring things in foot-pounds per minute. I don't care, joules, dynes, ergs, whatever, but being able to work with measurable, observable, repeatable data and looking at human movement as not a unique species of kinematics, but looking at human movement the way that we would look at the way Humvees or stars or a thrown rock would behave, that is in fundamental physical terms. That's where the commitment is, to doing that kind of science, if you will, to developing a technology in that regard. And so right now, if someone were to step forward to Roger up, as we say, with an improved technique, I'd embrace it overnight and stick your name on it and call it CrossFit. I mean, that's just how that would play out. And I've got an audience that would accept that and accept it instantly. You know, everything's bullshit, folks, except some number of foot-pounds per minute expressed over some number of minutes. And that's what we're looking for. And we've made that standard very, very public so that just about anyone can step forward and throw their hat in the arena and make a contribution. That's who we are.
Let me step forward and say, take a couple more questions.
Please. Sir.
Before asking what could be interpreted as a confrontational question, I just want to add that I've been doing CrossFit for about a year and I have 3 CrossFit certs and I'm a believer in the method. But I think it's fair to say I spend a lot of time on the CrossFit website. There's a lot of great stuff on there, and I'm critical, I would say, of the exercise physiology community. And I'm just curious to know, like, what advice would you have the exercise physiology community? What would you like to see more of out of us, or what would you like to see less of, or do you even care?
I could just piss my pants with excitement over you taking a teleological approach here and committing to advancing human performance and not just developing exercise science for exercise science sake. My academic background, I'm a failed academic, was a phys ed and classical applied mathematics. And in mathematics, there's a wonderful divide between pure and applied mathematics. And what I'm concerned about in exercise science is that there's no applied exercise science where we can speak with conviction to the utility of this discovery in advancing output. That's what I would like to see. But I don't feel I don't feel that it's appropriate for me as an outsider to look into what you're doing. And I greatly appreciate the question. But as an outsider, realizing that I have a very limited and different perspective, that indeed would be my hope. What I would like to see is that you'd commit to advancing the technology of human performance so that the coaches out there in the phys ed department found your counsel extraordinarily valuable. That would be my hope for us all. In every implementation, what we found in the final analysis is the efficacy, the efficiency, or the safety, either of those three alone could have justified the implementation. Now, that doesn't suggest to me that there aren't CrossFitters getting hurt out there. Can you get hurt doing this stuff? Yeah, most assuredly you can. But I think that part of the answer lies in reassessing our risk tolerance for fitness. You know, you want me to make you a perfectly safe fitness program, I got it. You're doing it right now. No one's going to get hurt, you know. And the best way to decrease injury rates is to bring efficacy to zero. And I think that's maybe what's happened in the military environment. But, you know, we've got other data that doesn't seem to measure up. And I'll just pick on the Air Force because you're sitting here and willing. But it was interesting to me that I had an Air Force doc send me a letter, and he wants to do these studies, and he had some real concerns about some kind of in vitro kind of analysis, seemingly unaware of the fact that 80 or 90 kids now have gone through pararescue in doc without a single washout under our banner. And I was like, geez, you know, that if that study, if that metric doesn't have value, I don't know which one would, do you? We haven't had one, and this is a program with a 70% washout rate. And 15 or 20 of our kids have been honor grads through the program. But the safety is something that needs to be discussed. I don't doubt that there would be pools of people, places that have had problems with the safety. But I had a Navy doc tell me, and he just did this wonderful thing that MDs just about only can do, with this wonderfully condescending tone, tell me that he was a scientist and he couldn't work with anecdotes and he needed safety. And I told him, Doc, listen, stop. I go, if I had to design a program that was going to hurt people, it'd be yours. I'd run them all day and have them do the same calisthenics and, you know, feed them poorly and then run them some more. And eventually I'd see the level of stress fractures and knee and low back and shin splints and things that you do that are causing washouts in your midst. The idea of running people for hours at a time right out of the gate, where they don't have full functional movement out of the primary movers for that activity, makes no sense at all to me. So here's my experience with a new runner teaching them to squat. They don't even know where the line of action is to lower their center of mass and increase stability. And this is something that a plate tree can do. I mean, it's an essential ineluctable aspect of inanimate objects. As I decrease their center of mass, I increase their stability. But I got runners don't know where that line is even. They don't even know how to go through a full range of motion in the hip and knees. And the idea that you're then going to take that out onto the track and run it all day long, or out on the beach worse yet, and run these people and not incur significant injuries is just nuts to me. Just nuts. We don't seem to see it as readily out of the lower extremities, but we sure do. We sure do in the shoulder. For instance, if you had an abnormal articulation in the shoulder, I can't get it past that. Well, tell you what, let's go pitch 9 innings of fastball. That should loosen it up, right? It doesn't work. And you end up with these chronic overuse injuries that are just, they're endemic to most of the MIL programs. And so I want to see, in our approaches, I want to see full range of functional movement of all of the joints. And then I want to see that those mechanics played with until we have consistency, and then and only then ratchet up the intensity. And so we have a great track record with injured runners by teaching them to squat and letting whatever these injuries are. Look, and the problem in gait analysis and watching an athlete run is that I don't have a sufficient range of motion in the hip and knee to see what's not right in the articulation. It's almost as if we tested shooting from 3 inches away. Go, wow, he's a really good shot. The line of action's too short. I back you up 20 feet. Now I can tell you what you're doing wrong. You're low and to the right. Same thing happens when we teach people to squat. You'll watch videos of them running. You go, man, it looks like a good gait. I'm not quite sure what's not right here. We teach them to squat, and now I see exactly what's wrong with your line of action. Then we put you out back on the track, and we slip handsomely past that injury. Almost always. In our certification program, we're doing exactly that. We are teaching squat, dead, jerk, clean, sumo deadlift, high pull, just fundamental basic human movement, you know. And these are things, again, that I'll tell you, these are natural. These were invented by no man. They predate history by millions of years. These are things that you were designed to do. I think I'm running out of time here.